Esther is a young Jewish woman who becomes queen. As her people are being threatened, she discovers God has called her to be a leader for such a time as this. I'm reading from chapters 3 and 4. Then on the 13th day of the first month, the royal secretaries were summoned. They wrote out in the script of each province and in the language of each people all Haman's orders to the king's satraps, the governors of the various provinces, and the nobles of the various peoples. These were written in the name of King Xerxes himself and sealed with his own ring. Dispatches were sent by couriers to all the king's provinces with the order to destroy, kill, and annihilate all the Jews, young and old, women and children, on a single day, the 13th day of the 12th month, the month of Adar, and to plunder their goods. Mordecai told Esther, "Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this?" Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, "Go, gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
One of my favorite shows in recent years has been Ted Lasso on Apple TV. Have many of you seen it? I see a couple smiles and nods. If you haven't seen it, I really encourage you to put it on your watch list. This is a show that tells the story of an American football coach, Ted, who is recruited to become the manager of AFC Richmond, which is an English football team. Now, Ted has no experience with soccer, and early episodes show him making a lot of blunders, not only about life in England, but also just basic things about playing soccer. He just doesn't know a thing. But we are drawn to him. Ted is this endearing, lovable character because he is charming, he is a folksy optimist, and he believes in the importance of community and building community above all else. His coaching inspires his teammates so that even when they lose, they grow as people and as a team. And along the way, all of us viewers are given both important life lessons, and it's accompanied by a whole lot of Ted Lasso humor, which is really comforting and sweet along the way. There's this episode, though, in the second season where one of the teammates, Sam Obasanya, learns that the team's sponsor, Dubai Air, is owned by an oil company that is refusing to clean up an oil spill in Sam's native country of Nigeria. Sam, early on in this episode, talks with his dad, and his dad expresses great disappointment that Sam isn't doing more to make a statement. And Sam is obviously crushed by his dad's harsh words. And so as the episode continues, Sam is struggling with this. On the one hand, it's not his choice or up to him who sponsors his team and whose name is across the jersey of his team. On the other hand, standing up to big oil would help his people and support his people in his homeland, but could have devastating consequences on his career. And through the episode, we're watching as Sam tries to figure out where his place is and what his role is in the midst of this. Now, I brought a little clip for us to see this morning so we can see what Sam decides. Let's watch together.
What are you doing?
What, Dubai Air not paying you enough?
No. Dubai Air is owned by a horrible company. One that has turned the southern coast of Nigeria, my home, into a hellish, fiery swamp. I can no longer wear their name on my chest. Never again. Give me the tape, bro. Yeah, that's good. Hey, listen. I'd not expect you all to do this. But I hope you understand why we, as Nigerians, must.
Want me to tape?
What do you think you're doing?
We're a team, aren't we? Gotta wear the same kit.
In the moments after this scene, you watch the team take the field, and everybody has covered Dubai Air from their jersey, taking a stand alongside Sam. The crowd who watches the team come out, you can hear their shock ripple through the stadium. And among them, Sam stands beaming with pride, with a whole lot of nerves, but this deep sense of belonging. And I love this episode and this scene in particular because it reminds me that sometimes we find ourselves in a position to make a difference in ways we never would have expected. Just totally out of left field. Here we have Ted, who is an American football coach, who doesn't even appear on the scene we watched, and he doesn't know a thing about soccer, and yet he is influencing these group of people to find a sense of belonging and home. Then we have Sam, our soccer player, who is not an activist or a leader against big oil, and then even at the very end, the last person to put tape on his chest is named Jamie, and he's known in this show to be somebody who only cares about his own good looks and his own good skills, and here we see him just inch forward in caring for others and showing that he's part of this team, something he's never considered before. And now we watch as new opportunities appear for each of these people. And it began because Sam felt compassion for his home country and realized that he was in a very unique position to make a statement, protesting against those who were actively causing harm to his family and friends and countrymen. Silence, he comes to realize over the episode, is complacency, and that will not do. He's been given this position, this team, for such a time as this. There are times in our life where circumstances outside of our control intervene with how we thought life would go and what it would look like. Suddenly, you're faced with a choice. Having the information you do now, do you continue on your merry way? Do you ignore it? Do you stop and make a change? Do you stand up to the challenge that has been put in front of you? When I was a child, one of my uncles was diagnosed with cancer, and I've shared a little bit about this before, but I remember so vividly standing in the kitchen of my grandma's house as my uncle shared with him both the news of his diagnosis, but also the good prognosis that accompanied that. The good prognosis didn't seem to stop our tears at all, and my aunts and uncles and my cousins, my parents and my siblings, we all stood there together holding him and crying ourselves for what this meant. And at one point, someone lifted up that maybe the kids should leave so Neil could have some space to talk more freely among the adults. And he paused and he said, "No, we're in this together. They're part of the family too." As an adult, when I look back on this, I realize that, of course, it wouldn't have been wrong for adults to want time as adults to process information and to maybe share information that wouldn't be friendly for young ears. But including us signaled something to myself and my siblings and cousins. It told us that we belonged, and whatever was coming ahead for my uncle was something that we would face together as a family. We were ready. We were in it together, and we had been made this family for such a time as this. Can you think of similar times when life happened and some sort of choice was presented to you? Would you stay quiet? Would you speak out? Would you join with those around you for support and sustenance? When one of your colleagues said something hurtful about someone else at a meeting, do you sweep it under the rug or do you find a way to tenderly confront them and to make some amends? When a friend of yours is having a really hard season in life and is deep in grief, having a big loss that they experience, do you wait for them to call or do you show up ready to share a meal or clean their bathroom or do whatever it is that they need for that day? Sometimes making this call is easy. We can see clearly the next right step on our path ahead, but other times it isn't so clear-cut because so much of our lives lives in this in-between gray area. Or we might struggle because we feel like we don't have the right set of skills or gifts, or maybe we feel nervous about the implications on our own life. What do we do then? This morning, we heard part of the story of Esther. Hers is a book that is filled with drama and action and continually is wrestling with this question. But Esther's story has everything we love in a good story. It's got a beautiful and a kind queen, a powerful king, a wise underdog. It has an evil villain, and death is looming always on the horizon. It's a captivating read. And this book is snuggled right in the middle of the Old Testament. It's a story filled with drama and courage. And even though it never directly mentions the name of God, it is a story that is filled with God's presence and wisdom and power. The story invites us, the readers, to look closely for signs of God's activity within its pages. And it's filled with these odd coincidences and other familiar melodies and notes that show us that God, even without being directly named or seen, is all over the pages and story of Esther. This is one of the reasons why I love this story so much, because I think it makes Esther relatable in this way. We watch Esther navigate life, discerning God's wisdom, wrestling with her faith and choices in her life in the same way that we do. What I mean is that instead of having a voice from God boom and come out of heaven, or a burning bush appear, or miracles that clearly direct her, instead, God is at work in the story of Esther, in the people that surround her, in the nudgings of her heart, in the ways that she is encouraged to trust God. And that feels a bit like how you and I navigate our lives and decisions too. Let's set the scene a bit for the story today. This story takes place in modern-day Iran, and it happens about 500 years before the birth of Christ and about 100 years after the Babylonian exile. What this means is that many of the Jews had returned home, but some had stayed put, and Mordecai and his niece Esther are among the Jews that chose to stay in this area after the exile had ended. They found something that many of us have learned throughout our lives, which is both God and home can be found anywhere. Esther is raised by Mordecai, and they are faithful Jews, we learn, who are kind and compassionate and trustworthy. Now, in the first chapters of Esther, we learn that the king is in need of a new queen, and that's a whole other story of drama that you'll just have to read on your own to learn about. But the king arranges this sort of bachelor-style contest to decide who his new queen is going to be, and so women from all around the area come to present themselves, and our beautiful, compassionate, and noticeable Esther is given the crown. But for reasons not entirely known to us at the time, Esther and Mordecai keep her Jewish ancestry a secret. As the chapters and pages continue, we learn that this was a wise choice because here enters our evil villain, Haman. And after Haman and Mordecai get into a disagreement, Haman overreacts by devising a plan not only to get rid of Mordecai, but to eradicate all Jewish people from the kingdom. He is the right-hand man to the king, and he uses this position to take advantage of the king's trust and to use him as a puppet to get his own plan in action. And so a decree goes out that all Jewish people would be killed. Mordecai then sends word to Esther, who is now the queen, and pleads with her to intervene. Certainly, you must be able to do something. And so Mordecai and Esther work together, and they make plans for her to reveal her Jewish identity to the king, to plead for mercy, to ask him to reverse this decree. But doing so will put her life in danger, not only because she's revealing herself as someone who is Jewish when there is a decree out against their life, but also because even the queen is not allowed to approach the king without being summoned. Mordecai responds to Esther in the midst of this conversation and says, being queen is not going to save you. Even if you do nothing, it's not going to save you. And even if you do nothing, I trust that God will find a way to save the Jewish people. But who knows? Maybe it is you, Esther. Maybe you have been made queen for such a time as this. This conversation between Esther and Mordecai gives Esther courage, and like many people of faith, she's experiencing this invitation from God that is set before her, an opportunity to seek God's wisdom, to trust in God's presence, to act in courageous ways that will lead to the redemption and healing of God's people. Like many heroes of faith, Esther chooses to stand with this courage and trust, even in the face of destruction. She says, yes, if I perish, I perish. And off she goes. This reminds me a little bit of that last line in that Ted Lasso scene we watched where Jamie Tartt stands and said, we're a team, ain't we? We gotta wear the same kit. We're in it together. Esther has agreed to speak to the king on behalf of her people, but at the very same time, she's gathering her people around her. She asks Mordecai to bring all the Jews in the community together, inviting them to fast and to pray for 3 days. Esther knows that she needs her team, her community surrounding her, if she's going to move forward with her plan. And so she turns to the basic tenets of her faith, bringing community together in prayer and fasting as they seek God's guidance. This exchange reminds us that God has created each of us with intention and purpose. God has made you within community to be a person that makes a positive impact in the world, sharing God's story of love and redemption with everyone. In the book of Romans, Paul writes this. He says, love unambiguously, hate what is evil and hold on to what is good. Love each other like members of your family. Be the best at showing honor to each other. God promises to be at work in our lives and in the world, and does so most clearly through the actions and the presence of God's people. Through you and me, we share the goodness and hope of God to a hungry world. I love this passage from Romans, because, man, doesn't that just draw you in? Love unambiguously. How are we to live together? We are to love unambiguously. We are to love and care for one another as if we are all one family. We are to show honor to everyone. Paul is telling us to make sure that no one questions or has any reason to question our words, our actions, but that our whole life is a testament to our trust in God and our faith in Christ. God gave Esther a unique place in life, gave her the opportunity to use her kindness and compassion, the trust she had gained with the king, to make a big impact in the world. And even though the name of God is never written on the story of Esther's pages, we see God continually at work in her life and in the life of the people around her. And Esther reminds us that even when things seem impossibly difficult, even if the presence of God seems way far off, even if the only thing that seems to readily surround us are evil schemes and death on the horizon, that even in these places, God is present. God is at work through the gifts and the strengths and the people of your life, through the community that surrounds you and the choices you make. God is present, working in and through it all. We see the fingerprints of God's presence through my uncle and the gathering of our family around the kitchen that day. We can see it in Sam as he found courage in his voice and solidarity from his team to tape over their sponsor name. And we see it in Esther, who finds herself in this unique position to change the mind of the king and to save her people. In all of these places, and whatever the situation you might find yourself in, God is right there in the middle of it. God has given you gifts and a community to uphold you through whatever struggle you face. The book of Esther celebrates the presence of God and the ways that God is at work in and through relationships, through community, through trusted conversations, reminding that each of us have been made for such a time as this. The world needs you. The world needs your voice, your unique gifts, your actions, and the perspectives that you can bring to this time and place. The world needed Mordecai to encourage and support Esther in her work. The world needed her surrounding community to uphold her in prayer and fasting. The world needed Esther to be courageous and brave and do something that no one else was in the position to do. But the world even needs people like the king, who could see the error in his ways and could change his mind and repent. Together, we see a commitment from God to be present in and through the lives of all people. We see various ways that God has made us for such a time as this. Now, through these last few weeks, we have been focusing on a variety of heroes of faith, people who have trusted in God and have acted in ways that are courageous and brave. But one of the common threads that I see woven throughout all of these stories is a God who is faithful, a God who is present and true, a God who does not give up on you, a God who is committed to the ongoing redemption of God's people, and shows up in you, in me, in Esther, in Mordecai, to help make this happen. The same thread of God's persistence and God's faithfulness is a thread that is woven through your life as well. God is committed to loving you, to redeeming you, and to loving all people. How might God be inviting you to be made, to be alive, to be at work for such a time as this? Perhaps there's an area of justice that God is nudging you towards. Perhaps there is a relationship that God might be directing you toward, offering opportunities for growth or healing, forgiveness. How is God calling you to be tender and kind, courageous and brave this morning? God has created you for such a time as this, and God promises to be with you, guiding you through the time that is ahead. And God does not send us alone. Just as Esther was surrounded by her community, you too are surrounded by community. The people of Messiah Church are in this together. Christians of every denomination around the world are in this together. We are a community to support and to cheerlead, to pray and to encourage, because God is calling us as individuals and as a church to be courageous in the ways that we love one another, in the ways that we care for God's created world, and in ways that we dream for what could be next. I do not yet know all the places where God is calling us, but I do know that wherever and whatever it is, that God will be with us and God will see us through. We will make an impact in this world by loving God and loving our neighbor. For this and for you, I give thanks. Let's pray. Gracious and good God, thank you for the story of Esther and for her courage. Help us to learn from her story that we see anew the ways you are at work in our lives and in our world. Help us to consider the places and people you are calling us to serve. And help us to trust that you have made us for such a time as this. Guide us, O Holy One, all of our days. And all your people say, Amen.